the operation, if you like to say. And so, hey, the point of Stand the River is for our folks to get a chance to share all that the Lord has taught over the last 4 months. And we hope, my hope for the program is that when it comes through, that their love for Christ increases. That's really what we hope. And so Berlin's going to get a chance to share a lot of what he's learned about the Old Testament. And the reason we do this is as an oral examination is because we know that when you're talking with people out there, if you're interacting with people, you don't have a chance necessarily to grab your notes, your stuff, and you want to be ready to make a defense of who Christ is and share the love of Christ with others. And the story of the whole Bible, not just the New Testament, where a lot of people are drawn to it. I don't understand the Old Testament, so I want to skip ahead to the New Testament. So this will be a fun time with us today, and so we're excited about it. So I want to pray for Berlin, and then Nicole's going to start us off with some stuff here. So, Father, we thank you for your kindness. Thanks for bringing Berlin to the Institute. Thank you for the joy he has been for us. Thanks for his friendship. Thanks for the way he has served so faithfully in South Dallas. Thank you for the team around him, for the community around him there. And I just pray today that if there's any anxious thoughts in him or any anxiety in him, that you just give him clarity of thought and give him peace as he shares the wonderful story of your word and your truth. And I pray that he wouldn't use his gifts to impress us today, but just to serve us as he shares the word with us. And so we're grateful for a chance to celebrate him and encourage him today.
First question. You just heard Ron articulate that the whole program is slowing this morning. Do you feel like that's happened for you over the past 4 months?
I do feel like that's happened because I thought that I had reached, I think, a max of what I could. And the more time I spend in the Word, the more I see myself and how much I am not where I thought I was. As far as being surrendered to him fully, and how there's always more, and how it's a daily thing and not the coasting situation of God. It's a daily surrender.
Okay, let's jump into some scripture memory.
Okay, let's go.
Okay, I will either give you the title or the verse references, and you give me the verse and then whatever else.
Okay.
Does that make sense? Okay.
No.
So, give me a verse for all have sinned.
All have sinned, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Romans 3.
Romans 5:8 or 1 Peter 3:18?
Romans 5:8. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 5:8.
What's the title of it all?
Romans 5:8.
Sorry, the all have sinned.
All have sinned.
No, all have sinned.
Sin's penalty. Where Christ ascended.
Close. Christ paid the penalty.
Christ paid the penalty.
Must receive Christ.
Must receive Christ. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. But with the heart, one believes and is justified, and with the mouth, one confesses and is saved.
What verse is that?
That verse is first. I'm blanking out.
You know it. Friends.
I In 517. Therefore. Second Corinthians 517. Therefore, if any. Therefore, if any man says he is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. There, the old and the new has come.
Good job. Let's do the word.
The word. 2 Timothy 3:16. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness. 2 Timothy 3:16.
I missed one part on that.
Profitable for. Profitable, all scripture is breathed out by God, profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness.
There you go. Isaiah 41:10 or Philippians 4:13.
I can do all things through Him who gives me strength. Philippians 4:13.
His provision.
His provision. And my God will supply every need of yours according to His riches in glory in Christ Jesus.
Berlin, out of all the scripture that you've memorized this semester, which one has stirred your affections for God the most?
I would say Romans 8:1. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ.
Awesome. Okay, great. We are now going to go to keywords and short outlines.
Okay.
So I will give you either the book, keyword, or the short outline, and you give me the other two that I don't
need. Okay.
Okay? Let's start easy. Genesis.
Genesis. Beginnings. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, and creation, fall, blood, time.
Good job. Holiness is the keyword.
Leviticus. Way to a holy God and by sacrifice and a way to a holy God by separation.
So the second one is a way to.
It's a way to. Say again.
You said way to a holy God by sacrifice, which is right. And the second one is a way to a holy God by separation. It's a different word that starts with a W.
Walk with a holy God.
Yes. What about judges?
Judges, failure, the climb before the judges, is the end of the outline. The climb before the judges, I forgot what it was. Climb before the judges.
Something through and something after.
Deliverance through the judges and something after the judges. Coming for the judges, deliverance through the judges, the time of the history. And it's not destiny.
Are you better on this?
Samuel, then Saul, and then Saul and David.
Yep.
And find Saul left it.
Great job. Nehemiah.
Nehemiah. Walls. Reconstruction of the wall and restoration of the people.
Love it. What book was the most fun for you to study this semester?
What was the most fun for me to study? Probably Genesis. Hosea. The image is the unfaithful spouse, and then God's interior love.
The crab. The image is great fish.
Prophet is Jonah, and God's love for the nations is
Micah.
It's not that bad. Swords and plowshares, and
what does the Lord require? Okay, let's do one more. Let's go to the back.
Why, Lord? Question mark.
Good job. Great job.
Okay, buddy. We're going to jump into some handles here, and then this will be a little more conversational, but some of this will be, I'm going to ask you to give me more detail on certain answers, but give me four categories of a biblical worldview.
Four categories of a biblical worldview are creation, fall, redemption, restoration.
Yep. Tell me the three questions of the Columbo tactic.
How did you come to that conclusion? What do you mean by that? And how do you consider it?
If somebody's talking to you about the word, let's say we were just talking about this with Lydia, but you're down 3 p.m. service at South Dallas, and at the end of it, they say, man, I'm having a hard time believing God's word. Feels like an outdated book. How can you trust it? How would you back the inerrancy of Scripture?
How would I back the inerrancy of Scripture? I would tell them that about how the word came to be, how we had it today, how God. How God produced it, how He preserved it, about prophecy, and about my personal testimony. And there's a fifth one I can't think of, but pretty much that He gave it to us.
Yeah, those are words say by itself.
And all scriptures read up on that.
So there's a profession.
Professional.
Four things you would talk about if someone was discussing the emotional problem with you.
I would talk about Puppy's Bound Cross.
Okay.
Puppy's Bound Cross.
Okay.
The reason and how God can deal with people over time. And then it's important.
Forge your acronym, right?
Yeah. I got all the T's. Red Forge. No.
Okay. How about the six P's of kingdom?
You have to have the kingdom, carry the kingdom, the promise kingdom, the progressing kingdom, part of the kingdom, the prophesied kingdom.
What's the part of the kingdom about?
The part of the kingdom is about the apostasy of the kings after Solomon.
So give me three words that rightly define the Trinity.
God's distinction is the unity and the
everything. If you take away distinction and you want to talk about unity and equality, what would that be called?
That would be called.
Tell me about the cycle of sin and judges. Four to five things happen.
There's sin, supplication. Sin, slavery, supplication. Salvation.
Yep, great job. Okay, let's talk about the Abrahamic covenant. Where can I find the Abrahamic covenant in the Word?
In Genesis. 12, 13, 15.
15 is correct, 12 is correct.
7.
Yep. How about the Davidic covenant?
7 Samuel 7.
That's on the test. Abrahamic covenant.
What is it?
The Abrahamic covenant. Tell me about the three parts of that.
Land, sea, and blessings.
Okay. How about the Davidic covenant?
House.
What is, explain one of those two.
So the house is genetic heritage. It's family line to represent the dynasty.
Okay, good. And what are the purposes of the law?
Revelatory and regulatory.
Okay, and the types of law?
Ceremonial, civil, and immoral.
How many kings, tell me about the kings in the north and the south.
There were 0 righteous kings out of 19 in Israel. And there were 8 righteous kings out of 20.
Where would I find the story of the talking donkey in the scripture?
It's donkey. Genesis. No, Numbers.
Yep. Where would I find the bronze serpent?
The bronze serpent is in.
How about the kinsman redeemer?
In the group.
What was his name?
Boaz. Okay.
Where would I find the story where the temple was first built?
That would be in 1 Kings.
Great job, man. And the walls of Jerusalem were built.
That is Nehemiah.
Great job. Great job. Okay. So, same guy, freaking service. He is, he's third barman. He was really entertained. He gave a great sermon, but afterwards, he comes up to you and he goes, hey, I was reading in the Bible and I was reading the story of the Canaanites. And, this is what, I love what Marvin was teaching out of Philippians, man, that sounded great. But when I started reading about in my Old Testament this week, I saw the story of the Canaanites where God, you know, when I read about it, it looked like he wiped out all the Canaanites, told him to wipe them out completely. And it just looks like it was an ethnic cleansing, or he is a genocidal maniac. And so I don't understand. I'm good with the New Testament. Okay, but the Old Testament sure seems like you serve a really harsh, I don't want to say evil God that would wipe people out like that. How would you respond?
Well, I would tell him that the God in the Old Testament, God in the New Testament, is the same God. As we see in John 1, it's in John 1, 2, and it's a building. This is why it says, let us make man
after. Now I'm out on the New Testament.
So they're the same. And then, second, I pray, let me know.
So it still seems, I heard what you said, so you're saying it was a moral cleansing, so the Canaanites, you're saying they were morally not very good people. Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Okay. Please answer that yes. And so, but it seems like he came down on them, but he gives the Israelites pass. That doesn't seem fair.
Well, he is specifically using the Israelites for a specific purpose, to bless the world. And like I said, God is sovereign. There's some things that he's wanting to do that we are going to do. Think about his grace, then all of us deserve to be benefit from him. Right? And so at any time they decide what he did, but he doesn't. And so they all confess.
Okay, so I'm gonna keep pressing. I like that you said he's a God of grace, but is he only a God of grace for, in the Old Testament? Is he only a God of grace for the Israelites?
No. There were other people groups and individuals that were not Israelites, like Rahab in the conquest era, where she provided assistance to Joshua. To some spies that went in. And she was saving her family to save because of her faithfulness to them. And not only was she spared, she's also a part of the lineage of Christ.
Good. And then any other examples of where prophets God sent that were Israelites to non-Israelite places and they responded? Prophets that went to place they really didn't want to go.
So Nineveh, right? God sent Jonah to Nineveh.
Yeah.
And Jonah didn't want to go because he thought they deserved it. And God, in his grace, allowed them to be spared.
Yeah, they repented. So, yes, that's a great, when people say that, and they say, we're just feeling right now. You could also talk about that some of that language is hyperbolic. It's you didn't wipe every person out of their line to continue, but it was, that was some of that language. You could talk about the fact that you did discipline the Israelites too, right? They had consequences for their sin. It wasn't like there was many that, you know, were not spared. So you didn't just show favoritism here. You used those people when God was sovereign, and anybody who believed, he offered a way for them. So. The other thing you talked about there too, Berlin, is just the amount of time that it took for God. He gave him, you know, 400 years or so to repent. And so it wasn't a quick, fast judgment there. And so all that was there it is. okay. Hey, you did good, brother. I'd love for now for you to probably part you with the most on. Is walk us through the story of the Old Testament for 20 minutes. At 5 minutes left, Nicole will hold up 5 minutes just to let you know you're pretty close to the end.
Okay.
Do you want me to do that or will it turn off?
No, it'll be good.
Okay, just know that when I do this, it means 5 minutes.
Just do this and don't do this. So I don't think it's like 8 minutes.
Yeah. It'll be right here. Right here.
Whenever you're ready.
Okay. All right, so. Something that I like to do when I'm feeling down or when I'm in a spot where I doubt God or don't believe in all of this. Sometimes I don't believe the Bible. I just think it's ridiculous. And then I'm like, am I really a Christian? Is God really there? And what I'll do is I will go to NASA.gov and go look at the footage
meditate on what I'm seeing. Meditate on the stratosphere and upper atmosphere and stars and whatever photos they have on there. And it just makes me think about Genesis and the beginning of things and how in the beginning was the Word. The Word was God. And the Word was with God. And how this one says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was formless, void, and the Spirit of God, and darkness was on the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God hovered over the waters. And God said, let there be light. There was light, and God saw the light, and that it was good. And so, 7 days later, when God rested, he had spent 6 days creating everything that we know in the known universe. In the unknown universe that we haven't seen. And the pinnacle of that creation was man. God made a man called Adam. And he made his wife called Eve. So, he set them in this place called the Garden of Eden, which is a paradise. It was perfect. They had perfect harmony with God, with each other, and with the creation that he told them to steward and be in charge of. However, there was another being that existed around the same time, or before Adam and Eve, I don't know, called Satan, who was a fallen angel, who was in God's, I'll say, in his court. And Satan wanted to be higher than God. And so God expelled him and other beings out of heaven. So, for whatever reason, Satan has access to the garden and access to God's creation, which is a little lower than what he did as a created being. Satan has a created being. And so, God has set two plants in this garden. One is the tree of life, and the other is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And he gave them pretty much one don't do command, which is do not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good. So what did they do? They eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil after they had been tempted by Satan, which is their enemy, which he wants to flip the script on the order of everything and put animals before humans and God last, right? So they do this, and they are aware of what they have done. Sin has entered creation for the first time, and they are separated from God. They are separated from each other, and they are separated from the creation that they are supposed to steward. And so God begins to deal with this, and he has them realize what they've done. And he tells them that in Genesis 3, that he is going to remove them from the garden, and that they are going to be separated from them, separated from each other, separated from the creation. And he also tells them that the serpent that tempted you, the seed of the woman, is going to crush the head of the seed of the serpent. Okay, bye. They leave the garden, and then time rolls on. He tells them also be fruitful and multiply. I missed that part. Be fruitful and multiply. So they are fruitful and they multiply, and then sin enters. Sin just becomes rampant. Sin is like a cancer that just spreads. It takes what is good and just warps it. Right, and so sin being that anything that we think, say, or do that does not please God. And so sin multiplies, and then eventually there is a descendant called Noah. And God sees that he is righteous above all the other people that are there by his standards at the time, and or always. And God tells Noah, I'm going to flood the earth, I'm going to flood it in judgment, I'm going to destroy everything that's in it, because man has just run rampant and wild. There's some weird creatures in here called Nephilim. They're not supposed to be here. We'll get to that another time. but I'm going to destroy everything. And so Noah builds his ark. Everything on earth dies. Noah's family is saved. And Noah also, by the way, is the continuation of that seed from Eve, Adam's wife, at the very beginning. So Noah survives, leaves the ark, and then God tells him to be fruitful. Multiply. And then they do, and they start spreading out. Sin becomes, continues on as it does, as a spiritual cancer that all Adam's sins have. And then we get to this place called Babel. And the people of Babel, they decide. decide to build a city and a tower, despite God's ordinance to go spread out. And so God comes down because despite the fact that these people are trying to build a tower glorify themselves, despite their trying to reach God, God still has to stoop down and reach down to us. Right? So all of a sudden, Abba Yang, come get down. What was God this eagle? You send me, you understand me. Neither did they. But they understood what God was saying, which was move, right? Spread out. And this is important because a little bit later, God's going to tell this man named Abram, I'm going to make you fall as many nations. If they don't spread out, that will be so. But that's God's program. And so here we go. So they spread out because we're all speaking different languages. They can't stay together and continue building this city. And then we fast forward to a few centuries later to a man named Abram from the land of Ur. God calls him out, and he makes a covenant with Abram. And he says, I'm going to give you land, seed, and blessings. I'm going to make you the father of many nations. And your descendants are going to outnumber the sand on the seashore. And so Abram has sons. He has a son, named Isaac. Isaac has Jacob, who is also called Israel. Israel is the father of 12 sons, who are known as the 12 tribes. They're the heads of the 12 tribes of Israel. And one of these sons is Joseph. Joseph is a bit of a braggart, so he gets himself in trouble by letting his family know how important he is over his father and his brothers in dreams that God gives him. Probably should have kept it to himself, but he didn't. And so his brothers decide to show him how much what he is to them, and they put him in a pit, and they sell him to slavery in Egypt. And then he, in that time, goes from the pit to the palace, being Pharaoh's right-hand man, the king of Egypt, the most powerful man in the world at the time. And so he is able to save his family that betrayed him, and as well as the Egyptian civilization. So time rolls on, and I should add that Judah, that family, was called out as something special, and what was said to him was that the scepter will never depart from your house. So that's Isaac to be the fool of Israel. And then, so 400 years after this, Joseph is long dead. Pharaoh, is a new Pharaoh, is king of Egypt, he's forgotten all the things that have happened in Egyptian history. And the Israelites have outnumbered the Egyptians exponentially, which is God's promise of much seed taking place in this place. It's not their final land, but they're their God. And so Pharaoh and the other Egyptians, they kind of freak out about this. So they say, hey, we're going to make y'all some slaves. We're going to turn you into a workforce. Because you're outnumbering us, we need to kind of figure out what to do with you. And so that's what they do, right? And so he also decides to kill the firstborn sons. God spares, in his sovereignty, one child, Moses, who grows up in Pharaoh's household in God's irony. And as an adult, he commits a crime, runs away. God finds him where he is and says, hey, I'm going to make you the providence for my people. I'm going to work through you to free my people because I've seen what's happening to them and I want them to be free. And I'm a God who keeps my covenants. So Moses goes to Pharaoh to tell him to submit to what God is telling him to do, which is let my people go. Pharaoh says, no. And he goes to God, says, hey, he's not doing this. And so God essentially wages war on Egypt without the Israelites ever having to throw a punch or even a sword. So with nine plagues, he ends with the final plague, which is the plague of killing the firstborn son. And so this is where we can insert the story of Passover. He tells the Israelites, I want you to kill a year-old lamb that is spotless and without blemish, paint its blood on the posts and lintels of the doors. When the angel of death passes through, If it sees that your doorpost is painted with blood, it's going to pass over. But if not, then any firstborn son in that house will die. So that happened. Egyptians did not do it. And then that was a very sad night for the Egyptian civilization that night. So Pharaoh said, get out of here, go on. And then Egypt is essentially plundered by its own slaves because of the slave God. Right? And they are also destroyed in the Red Sea after God went to sleep, helping get out. So the next thing that happens is they are in the wilderness, and God takes this moment to explain to them who he is and what the relationship with him should be in a very organized way and structured way, because God is holy. He wants them to understand, I'm holy, and my holiness is dangerous. I love you, but you have to be careful about how you interact with me, because I can, like, kill you, right? And he shows them how to do this, and what's important about this is, as nations have spread, they have many different gods, and kind of think of their gods like their mascot, let's say the Cowboys over here, this mascot over here, and they have different ideas of what a god is and our desire to have something to worship, right? And so he's making it clear, like, you guys image me, you represent me. So if you don't fully represent me, I can't have that, because I don't want to cause confusion. So do what I'm saying, I will be with you, and you will prosper, right? So he does this, and they are taken to the promised land that was promised to Abraham centuries before, and they get right out to the outside, and then they spy out the land. They get two reports, a bad report and a good report. Most of the old generation believes the bad report. And so God says, y'all are going in, and also Moses isn't going because he disobeyed God. Sucks for Moses, but at least you get to see it. So they go in with Joshua as the new leader, and they conquer. And one of the things that God made clear to them in this time was, hey, you're going to go through, you're going to settle, but I need you to drive out the other inhabitants in the land. Because one, it's your land. Two, I don't want them influencing you, because they're going to corrupt you in some way. So I need you to purify this space, because it's yours, and because you're my people, and I know y'all, so get them out. And they settle, but they didn't completely drive out the land. They kind of get comfortable, and then they slowly become corrupted over time. And then over time, this apostasy continues, and then God has implemented people called judges, which are, I would say, they're like warrior chieftains that God uses through six cycles, well, several cycles sin, slavery, supplication, salvation, and silence. And so the final judge is a judge named Samuel. And God has Samuel anoint this man named Saul a king, because the people of Israel reject God as king. And God says, okay, sure, we'll give them what they want. That's how a king is going to treat you, but sure, go ahead, have a king. And then Saul is pretty good. He's all right, handsome guy, tall guy, and looks like a king. They get to be like the other nations, like they wanted, but Saul does not completely follow the Lord. He messes up. And God eventually rejects Saul as king. And God tells Samuel, I pick another king, go to this guy named Jesse's house, and you're going to find me. So he goes to his house, and there's this shepherd boy named David. And so God has gone from the tall bachelor-looking king to this random shepherd boy in the backwoods of Israel. And so David becomes king, and he excels as a servant of Jerusalem and a warrior. Saul sees this, gets jealous, starts his vendetta with David, and eventually dies. David becomes king. And David is loved as a king. This is kind of the beginning of the golden age of the people of Israel. And he wants to build God a temple, but God says, no, you're kind of beset by war. I don't want that for you. But because your heart is with me, before me, I'm going to promise you, I'm going to make a covenant with you. And that covenant included that his house, his kingdom, and his throne will be forever and always, right? So, David was great, but David made mistakes. Big mistakes. One of them being that he slept with one of his warrior's wives, killed that man, had a son. God dealt with it, and then he had another child, Solomon. And Solomon, after David died, becomes king. And he asked God for wisdom to rule. And God gives it to him. And Solomon also builds God's temple for him. Great temple. And his house. The thing about Solomon is, although he was very wise, he was a little bit too smart for his own good and did more than what he should have with his wealth that God provided for him. Had too many wives, more than what he was supposed to, which was more than one. And he just got drawn away from the Lord over time. So the thing about David and his and Solomon is that they didn't do a great job with raising their children. And so this caused problems for decades to come. And that after Solomon, his first son, made a decision listening to some of his buddies about how to rule, which was a bit cruel for the people, and he split the people. Right, and this began a time where they were starting to pull away from the promise that God had for them, that God had for them. And then sin continues. They continue to not listen to God, they continue to rebel, they continue to sin with sin and combine with the nations that were around them, even the kings, right? Alliances that they were not supposed to have, marriages that they were supposed to have. And God lets them know to the prophets, hey, if you guys don't stop, then I'm going to make your enemies rule over you. So he gave them chance after chance after chance after chance, prophet after prophet. And they did. And so eventually both Assyria and Babylon took over, and Babylon took over everything. And they were taken into exile out of their land. But God was still faithful in that he was there for them, even in exile. He saved them, even in moments where they were going to be all wiped out, right? And he was faithful to keeping that seed from Genesis going. So we see that seed kind of pop up and plant up, sprout up every now and then in a moment with different descendants. And eventually God, even in his sovereignty, allows the rulers to let them go back home and begin to rebuild their city, rebuild the temple, which is where God dwelt, and rebuild the wall, right? Which is a great hoorah for any people at that time to have your city, have your walls, and then for the Israelites especially to have their temple back. And so eventually they all get to go back. There are three ways they all go back. And you would think that they would be thankful, but still, seeing that they are not capable in their own willpower, they begin to still fall away from God. And so they get warning, some more warning after warning, and then eventually they get warning after warning, and then God in these warnings lets them know, okay, there's going to be a time where you're going to have a messianic king who is going to do everything that you cannot do as my people. He is going to rule. He is going to conquer, and he is going to be faithful to me. He is going to be your provision, and a priest, king, and so on and so on. But until then, God is silent for 400 years. And that silence is broken by a baby and a manger in Bethlehem. And it is a reminder of that promise to Abraham, land, seed, and blessing. A reminder that God is faithful to even David, house, kingdom, throne, and that even while someone like me is looking at NASA's website, looking at the stars, South Austin went in a plane, looking at the stars, God told Noah, go outside and look at the stars, and if you can count them, number them, and your descendants is going to be more than that. So even while I'm looking at God, there are times before I was born that he was thinking about me and you, and you, and you, and you, and about how he's going to dwell with me come to you and be with you because he loves you, cares for you.
Where it says, weep no more, behold the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered, so that he can open up the scroll and set the seals. So you read that now and you go, okay, the Lion of Judah. What did you say about the tribe of Judah?
The tribe of the park.
Yeah. So you understand, it's talking about Jesus, the Lion of Judah. You see the Root of David brings the Davidic covenant, right? It's not the one that will sit on the throne for eternity. So the Old Testament now and the New Testament will pop up there before you. I know what that's about. More than just titles for Jesus, you know the story. And so I hope that really encourages you to celebrate Christmas this time of this year. So I want to turn over, I don't know who of your team is going to share, but anybody that wants to love you, I'll encourage you to serve.
Berlin will fall the third.
I was sitting here thinking about when you were at SCAD and you would call me and tell me that there were Jehovah's Witnesses on campus, and you're the only person I know that would go home and prepare in your dorm and go back to challenge them, because I always ran from them. So you are so brave to me and so courageous, and I'm just so thankful that God saw fit to allow me to bring you into this world to do his work. I'm just thankful, and I'm so proud that you're choosing him above all else. And I, as a mother, I remember when my son told me he loved God more than he loved me, which was painful, but I wanted that. I love you. I truly love you. As a brother in Christ, I love you. And as your mother, I love you. Thank you. But he told me, I asked him how he wanted me to pray, and he said, just pray I have fun. I had no idea this was what was happening. So I was sitting here praying the whole time. The way I should have prayed before. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing that. To wrap up, I just wrote down.